back. You're watching Power News. Well, in today's episode, we're discussing Maharashtra's power scenario. Mr. Rupal, I would like to ask you, even in the past, we have seen that lot many projects got delayed due to main plant equipment supply, BOP-related issues, fuel problems and land acquisition. Do we have proper coordination among central, state and other government agencies so that all the projects can be commissioned on time?
I think in terms of execution, a lot of improvements have taken place. And, you know, there are two parts of a project execution, pre-start, period and the post-start period. In India, you know, the pre-start period for the project has generally been very long, but with a lot of initiatives taken by the government, the pre-start period has been compressed. And as far as the post-start period is concerned, there once again, a lot of new vendors have come, a lot of new contractors have come. So I think, you know, the net availability of the execution force has increased dramatically. I'm quite optimistic that it's just a matter of a few years before, you know, the most of the projects will be done in time.
While we are in the process of sorting out the equipment supply issues, fuel supplies issues have taken on a new sort of dimension, where one of the private sector projects in Vidarbha has a mine which was allocated to it, a coal linkage, has been lost for environmental due to environmental concerns, and they are in the process of finding a substitute. And one more in coastal Maharashtra, with which the distribution company had a PPA, they have a problem with their import coal contract in Indonesia. So these are also new issues which we must be concerned about. While their plants are they are really coming up with their plants very fast, these fuel supply issues could have an impact on the commissioning of the plants as well as the price of the electricity which is supplied to the grid.
I definitely agree with what Mr. Rathore just expressed. We need to have better coordination. But I must say that when it comes to the IPPs, a certain amount of discipline is already coming now. The IPP projects cannot do financial closing until certain things are already in place. For example, the fuel linkage is there. You've got the full land availability. You've got environmental clearance, etc. So these kind of things, in a way, are making sure that the project doesn't start until all the things are in place. But I fully agree with him that we need to do a lot more coordination among various agencies which are stakeholders in the startup of the projects.
It's a transformation stage which we are passing through. So far, the generation has been either with the government agencies or it has been with the people who wanted a captive power capacity. If you see earlier, there was a discomfort in the industries on the availability of power, and they were more or less in the planning stage itself would build a capacity for a captive purpose. Now that is reducing. The reduction of that seemed to indicate very clearly that there's more comfort that going forward the government, either in central or in the state, is moving towards bringing independent power generations or additional capacity. So I think that itself indicates some kind of a comfort that moving forward we are looking for a better perspective.
I just want to react to issues about the capacity addition plans. The first issue about the dire need to have an integrated plan for the state. I would just give another example. If you look at the Konkan strip, in just three districts, the capacity of about 20,000 megawatts is under development. Now you can imagine what will be the impact if all this capacity comes up online. What will be impact in terms of local population, impact on environment, all the issues related to resettlement and rehabilitation, issues about water availability. The situation is very same in Vidarbha. Again, in 2 to 3 districts, we are talking about 40,000 megawatts of capacity projects. There again, that raises a lot of concerns about what will happen to water availability for agriculture, what will happen to water availability for drinking, whether enough water is available. So what we need to look at is to come out with a regional integrated plan for capacity addition. And then say, based on availability of resources, based on local environmental impacts, we can possibly have X megawatts in a particular region. And then find out which are base sites for that, and then go and communicate all these plans to people at large in a very open, transparent manner. That would be one way of addressing the issue of local opposition to projects, which is one of the offsided reasons why projects are getting delayed. So that is one issue we really need to take seriously. The second issue in similar line is about, currently we are operating in a shortage scenario. And what we are seeing through the competitive bidding processes and many of the trading transactions that are going on is, there is increasing tendency on part of these power developers to seek excessive market power and excessive rent. If you see the cost of power, that is just galloping, and there is little relation of that increasing power to increasing input cost. So this tendency of, you know, sort of making maximum profits in light of shortages, that again needs to be addressed very seriously. And I'm not just talking about Mumbai area, I'm talking about the overall capacity addition scenario in the country. The third thing that we need to look at when we are looking at this capacity addition issue is about the planning. Now, how many utilities today in the country have a long-term plan which will say, okay, this is our demand for the next 15 years, these are the kind of projects that we need, and these are the steps in which we are going to achieve that target. And that's where, again, the role of regulatory weakness, I would say, is coming out very starkly when the regulators are not looking into these issues of making distribution licenses accountable for long-term power purchase. Because in that scenario, they resort to short-term high-cost power purchase, consumers have to suffer, and then we end up in this vicious cycle of cross-subsidy and high tariff for industrial and commercial consumers. So all these issues need to be addressed in a holistic manner.
The entire power segment and the distribution segment is going through a change. There's a situation of open access, there's a situation of new capacities being created, and there's a situation of managing the present. Yes, one can plan for a longer term, but what happens when the open access comes into picture? What happens if you tie up a price, which, as he rightly said, is high now, and then through the open access the prices drop, where the consumer has a right to get a supply on his own? What happens to the capacity is tied up? So there has to be a balance which has to be struck as we go forward in this transition phase.
I think in this country we really have to, you know, make sure that we do the generation of power in a way that the cost is minimal. You know, that we are talking about future demand. Future demand is going to be very much dependent as to how you price the power. If you price the power so exorbitant that people can't afford, even your demand will never be realized. So I think, you know, we have to be mindful of the fact in this country, including in Maharashtra, the coal that we get, you know, has a huge amount of ash and non-combustible material. So therefore, you know, transporting them over long distances away from the source of coal and trying to produce power out of it is a straight addition to the cost of the power. So I think, you know, we really have to nip it in the bud. We have to, you know, take a look at it and take a pragmatic view that we are able to use our own sources of coal, first of all. There's no harm looking at imported coal sources, but, you know, we have to remember that end of the day, all the uncertainties which plague the cost of coal could reflect in the eventual tariff of the coal. Of the
power. Coordination among industry, state and center to sort out this issue. Mr. Rato.
Very few people realize that 80 to 85% of the cost of power is because of the fuel supplies. Yeah. And if fuel costs go up, not only quantities, but if the costs go up, the domestic coal, for example, and the imported coal, and we don't have a proper strategy at the national level or the state level or as in consultation with each other. And in addition to that, we don't have a regulator. But unless we have a regulator for the coal sector, it is going to be very difficult to control the tariffs.
Before we move ahead and discuss other issues, we'll take a quick short break here. You keep watching Power News.